Hey everybody, Matt Graham, MBS Live here with you on Wednesday, April 29th, 2020. Nice straightforward day for financial markets with two of the week's biggest ticket market movers or potential market movers having come and gone. Talking about GDP this morning and the Fed announcement this afternoon. GDP was every bit as weak as expected, -4.8 versus -4.0 forecasts. But bond yields and stocks ended up moving higher nonetheless. The issue was possibly confused to some extent by remdesivir availability speculation, saying that the FDA might fast track the coronavirus antiviral drug. But it wasn't really a big picture market mover, more of an intraday source of volatility for stocks and bonds. Bonds returned to previous yields. Stocks continued to move higher ahead of the Fed, at least until about 1 o'clock. Let's take a look at the chart from Refinitiv Icon. We can see stocks top out here about 1:19 p.m. And at that time, both stocks and bonds began moving slightly weaker ahead of the Fed. And when the Fed announcement actually came out, stocks sold off a little bit more, but not enough to derail the bigger picture trend for the day or the past 2 days, really. And past 2 days, how about going all the way back to the 21st and then taking the 21st? How about going all the way back to mid-March? So yeah, you could, you know, make a big case for an ongoing rally in stocks. But for bonds just bounced today and were a little bit weaker heading into the Fed and a little bit weaker heading out of the Fed. They found their footing as soon as Powell began speaking. Powell offered some reassurance that the Fed was in no hurry to remove accommodation, and that it would continue to buy treasuries and MBS in whatever amounts were needed to promote smooth market functioning and the transmission of monetary policy. In other words, the Fed is going to do what it needs to do in order for its policy to actually transmit its effects to the real economy. And with respect to something like MBS purchases, for instance, they may indeed quantify that as some level of mortgage refinance and purchase demand, or even real estate prices. And that is something that Fed research has shown that it cares about. And Powell actually said today that there is an accommodation component to its bond buying program, because heretofore he has said that it is all about providing liquidity. And it's definitely mostly about providing liquidity. But in today's press conference, he mentioned lower mortgage rates as an accommodative fringe benefit of the liquidity measures in the bond market. Either way, bonds liked it well enough. They didn't dislike it. And yields corrected and moved back in line with pre-Fed levels. MBS stayed relatively flat. If you're looking at UMBS 2.0s, a little bit of a different story, but a lot of that has to do with how strong they were yesterday, or the day before, really. And then the fact that they are more volatile right now, we're getting more errant bids that are maybe farther below the going rate than would be the case for UMBS 2.5s. A lot of you have asked, which should I be watching between 2.5s and 2.0s? The answer is definitely still 2.5s. That's where the liquidity in the market is. That's the lowest coupon that is super actively traded. 2.0 coupons will trade more and more, but we will let you know when we are shifting our focus onto that exclusively. Now, if you are floating or working primarily with a lender that has exceptionally low rates, say they have, you know, viable quote options as low as 2.875, 2.75, then you want to pay a little bit more attention to the 2.0s. Even then, 2.5s should still give you an indication of risk. And the movement in 2.0s is still largely a function of what is going on in 2.5s. Long story to explain that one, but the point is that we're not quite there yet as far as treating the 2.0 as our primary focus from an MBS standpoint. We will get there, but between now and then, 2.5s will do most everything we need them to do. If you want to be super duper cautious, you can follow 2.0s, but you will get false positives there when it comes to watching out for reprice risk. As far as locking and floating in general, the refrain is constant and unchanging. If you have a program that's anywhere off the beaten path, something that's not perfectly vanilla conventional, then There's an increasing risk that it's going to change in pricing or availability. So if it's competitive now and everybody's happy, that makes sense to lock. If we're talking about, you know, the most down the middle, conventional, conforming 30-year fix type stuff, it's a little bit more of a judgment call, but I would say anytime UMBS 2.5s are at 104 or above, it probably increases my personal predisposition to lock. And I think that, you know, in general, there isn't as much benefit to be had by playing the lock float game right now, unless you have quite a long time to wait and don't mind seeing some losses in the meantime. I can't emphasize enough, though, that that only pertains to conventional down the middle stuff. And I think most of you have seen what can happen from an uncertainty and from a fallout standpoint to such an extent that you're probably more lock biased than you have been in the past. And I think that is justified and smart right now. As far as what's coming up tomorrow, we have core PCE, not a big deal right now. Probably jobless claims and Chicago PMI will be the data highlights. Jobless claims, of course, kind of a moving target that are simply huge, much, much bigger than they ever have been in the past. And I think that limits the impact there to some extent. But something like Chicago PMI helps make the changing employment situation a little bit more tangible in terms of the impact it's having on the economy. Even then, in general, markets aren't exceptionally interested in trading economic data yet. And while that will definitely change when the data takes a turn for the better, it'll probably happen after markets are trading coronavirus-related updates and outlooks based on the incoming data there. So virus-related data, then economic data, as traders look for a shift in the bigger picture. Not there yet, so we're just kind of flying this holding pattern in bonds and then continuing to debate, discuss, and generally be amazed by the fact that stocks can continue to move higher as much as they have, given the way people feel about how the future might look. So they're telling us something. We don't know what it is, or maybe we do, but we're not going to speculate on that just yet. That's going to do it for today. Back with you guys tomorrow. Have a great rest of your day.